Hebrews chapter 11, beginning in verse 8. Now, as you know, verse 11 of the chapter of Hebrews is referred to as the Hall of Faith, right? Not the Hall of Fame, but the Hall of Faith. It's much more important to be in the Hall of Faith than it is the Hall of Fame. You and I might not ever make any kind of Hall of Fame. It don't matter, baby. If we've made the Hall of Faith, we've made it, right? So anyway, it's talking about the great things that people did through the greatness of their God who deposited faith within them, and they exercised that faith in many dimensions. Verse 8, by faith. Somebody say, by faith. Everything in the kingdom, it starts with faith. It begins with faith. It continues with faith. It consummates with and by faith. So by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited, or actually, that's the King James Version, New King James. I want to quote King James Version. It's actually more accurate. For he looked, somebody say, I'm looking too. He looked for a city that has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Oh, let's just dive right into this. Remember last week, we didn't look at the word in the original rendering from our English word builder. And listen, I'm not going to get this exactly right on the pronunciation. As close as I can get, it's technitis, which we have derived our word technician or even technique. And it speaks of course, God is that individual. He is that artisan, that's what it means. It means craftsman. It means a lot of different things. And it also has the clear connotation that it gives us the picture of God shaping and fashioning as an artist would, as a master craftsman would, that when he is finished with that product, with that project, it is something to behold. And that's the thing about a construction process. That's the thing about even, I don't know, but if you like art, I'm not much into modern art. I appreciate it. God bless him. But it's like, man, it looked like somebody got drunk and just took some paint through. But anyway, I shouldn't have said that. Let me stay on focus here. But anyway, I love art where people took their hands and chiseled something out of granite, out of stone. And there are still those artisans today. Many times when we think of those kind of artists, we think, oh, they're all gone. And, you know, only Michelangelo, you know, he was the last one. No, there are still, I tell you, there are so many stone artisans all throughout Mexico, definitely different parts of the world, though. But I don't know if you've seen some of the stone artisans from Mexico, what they do with Cantera stone. Absolutely beautiful. That's why it costs a lot of money, you know. And then also with what they do with marble and granite. And someone several years ago from this church, they blessed us, my family and I, with this solid marble statue of these horses running and intermingled together. I mean, it's a work of art, hand chiseled. So anyway, the thing about it is, in the natural, you know, that person, that artisan, you'd even take Michelangelo, you know, he started with a chunk of rock. And he just began to chisel and chisel and work at it until where it became a living stone, if you will. That's why the Bible calls us living stones. There's several reasons why. That's one of the reasons why, is that God starts on us, and really, most people, I kind of touched on this last week, most people, all they see is just something that I don't see it. That's what they see. They don't see it. They don't see the greatness in you. They don't see, especially when you're just starting out serving God. They don't see what you can become and what you can evolve and develop into. And the thing about it is, when God begins to remove some things off of us, when God begins to shape us and fashion us and mold us, and when God begins to build and he adds on to our lives those room additions and room expansions, and he blows the roof off and he elevates us and does all these wonderful things. And that construction process, it's messy And most people, we kind of look at this last week too, they can't see it. But when it's all done, then everyone wants to be it. When it's all done, then they want to say, oh, have me over. You know, I want to tell you, you know, it's kind of just like your life. When you're going through the process, a lot of people, they don't have anything to do with you. Because you're a mess, I'm a mess, and sometimes we make a mess because even though we're trying to do something good, we're still making a mess of this of the wonderful building blocks God has given us. And so a lot of those people, they stand away, far away from us and say, oh, nah, ain't nothing ever coming out of that rubbish heap. And then over the years, we allow God to fashion, shape, mold, add things, take some things away. Sometimes he's got to take more things away than add to us. That's another sermon. We'll keep going, though. And then when it's built, when it's done, when the work is unveiled, do you realize that there's a continual unveiling of who you are in Jesus Christ? When the canopy is pulled away from you and we stand back and say, my, the Lord has brought them a mighty long way and look what he has done in their life. We want to live next door to you now. You just increase, because now when you're around people like that, they just increase your property value. You know how it is? You take a neighborhood that's, you know, just so-so. When someone just completely renovates their house, guess what happens? Even the other people, they don't do a thing to their house. Their property value rises. So it is with people in the kingdom of God. When they've allowed God to do a good work, a big work, a complete work, every time you just hang around them, your property value goes up. Oh, some of you got that. Some of you got that. That's why I'm going to tell you something. There ain't no tenement projects here, baby. I'm looking at mansions. I'm looking at people who God has built and constructed and laid finery in. Not just the edifice, but everything inside too. Somebody say, oh, you're looking at a piece of art, man. You're looking at a piece of art. Exactly what you are. Don't let anyone tell you differently. Now, several of you came up to me last week. And when one person does it, and I have to explain a little bit more fully. I mean, all you guys are super intelligent. You know the word very well. But sometimes in my speedy delivery and the depth of which I come from that very few people can even remotely begin to inhabit, sometimes people aren't quite sure, but you always know my heart, and I so appreciate that. When I said this, talking about building, right, kind of in the crux of the message, I delivered this, and I could tell it was like, wow, that's good, but I'm not quite sure exactly where he's coming from, but I know it's got to be good. When you don't like the world that you're living in, build another one. Remember that? When you don't like the world you're living in, build another one. You know, and so someone said, you know, well, I don't like my marriage, so I can get another one, right? So now, no one actually said that. I just had to know. So I just had to throw that one in. I want to make it clear that ain't what I'm talking about, okay? So no one said that, though. But anyway, so I want to clarify. Even though you guys, you know, even those who came to me, they knew where I was coming from, but I clarify a little bit more. So I'm going to clarify this for everyone, because to me, this will help revolutionize your life. It really will. Because as Christians, as good faith/law-abiding Christians, we can have a propensity to endure the miserable. Because we think, oh, Jesus suffered, so should we. Now, I don't want to digress on that, but you guys know this. He suffered so we don't have to. He put up with stuff so we don't have to. Spiritually, emotionally, and physically, right? And those three categories cover about everything. And you know what? Also, relationally. He put up with the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the haters and the mockers and the spitters so we don't have to. You do not have to subjugate yourself to haters. You are not a doormat. You are not somebody that has to allow people to treat you like dirt. Let me modify that. You are a child of God. You are not a second-class citizen. You do not have to acquiesce your rightful place of self-respect. Don't you ever do that to anyone. Don't you think that if you let people run over you, that's meekness. Meekness is this. Meekness is complete strength under perfect control. That's what meekness is. Meekness is not letting people abuse you and continue to abuse you and keep abusing you and taking advantage of you and wiping their dirty feet all over you because they know you're going to lay down and keep doing that. I'm going to tell you something. You kick a dog long enough and eventually that nice dog is going to bite you. It's as simple as that. And for the life of me, I think what it is, either Christians have selective memory or they don't read their Bible at all or somewhere in between. It's like, haven't you ever read? Isn't that interesting? Jesus said that to a lot of his enemies and his opponents. Haven't you ever read? And then he'd quote scriptures. But really, it's like, you want to say it to so many Christians. Haven't you ever read when Jesus confronted the haters? He didn't put up with them. He didn't say, okay, if that's how you feel, but please let me try to be accepted by you. He said, the hell with you, I'm going on. I'm going so. Amen. What do you think in many regards that is? When he said, listen, if they don't receive you, dust your feet off and go to somebody else who will. I want to make this so clear because, see, this is all about building another world. I'm not saying, oh, we want to send people to hell. It's just, no, it's just that issue, that world, to hell with that. Because that's where that world came from. You do not have to subject yourself to mean-spirited so-called Christians. I let that train leave a long time ago, baby. I got off that train, and I don't allow that train to come into this station. It's like, nah. If you can't respect me, and if you don't like me for me as who I am, I don't need you. Hit the road, Jack, and don't you come back no more, no more. It's like, that's part of it. There's a lot of ancillary items here about, how many of you enjoying this? Yeah. There's a lot of ancillary items about building another world then. That's part of it. But anyway, is that you don't have to put up with that stuff. That's not who you are in Christ Jesus. Jesus didn't put up with it. You don't either. Absolutely not. Paul didn't put up with it. The disciples didn't put up with it, okay? So anyway, In that pretense, let's just continue to focus on this, is that build another world is all about this. When things aren't going well, and you become consumed with that thing or things, plural. How many of you have more than one thing that might be not going well? How many of you got things? It's like, Lord, I need some help here. So what you have to do is you have to get out of that world. Because it's dragging you down. Now you're consumed with it. Now your mind now starts promulgating the fear and the worry and the doubt. The unbelief. And now you're going from bad to worse. You get consumed with this world that isn't pleasant. You know, can I help you with this? Anytime you're thinking of something, how does it make you feel? How does it make you feel? If it doesn't make you feel good and happy and joyful and filled with faith and confidence and filled with the peace of God, that's a world you shouldn't be in.
Right, Pastor. Talk to me.
That's a world you shouldn't be in. You don't need to be in that world. So you need to create another world. How do you create another world? It's real simple. First of all, it starts in the mind. Whatsoever things are true, honest, just, pure, lovely. There be any virtue, there be any praise. Think on what? That's how you start creating a new world to begin with. And you know, because your life is going to follow where your mind is leading you. And of course, you know, you're going to be speaking what you're already believing, what you're already saying, what you're already thinking. So if it's a world over here that, you know, be it, I mentioned relationally earlier, if it's a relational issue in that world of relationships is not good, if it doesn't make you feel good, if there's no benefit, if there's no, I mean, you know, relationships, you're going to have ups and downs and all that kind of stuff, especially even a marriage. So I'm not talking about, you know, it's got to be continual euphoria and perfection. That's not the issue. The issue is any kind of relationship that is damaging you, and causing this world of chaos and destruction, that's not a world within the world that God wants you to inhabit. God wants you to inhabit a world filled, there again, with peace, blessing, prosperity, safety, joy. All. So we need to begin to build another world, because if you stay in that given world, the world of fear, the world of doubt, the world of worry, the world of, basically codependent relationships. You don't need those people. Stop being codependent. I can't get off of this. Somebody really needs to hear that. Those codependent relationships are a negative world. They're a bad world for you. You need to get out of there. So the moment you leave that world and go into a better world, man, your whole life just gets better. Amen. It improves dramatically. But it's up to you to build it. God's already built it for you. We just don't inhabit many times what he's built. So we need to leave a place there again that's destructive, that's unwholesome, that's selling us short, causing us to lose out of our full potential, all of that stuff. We need to leave that world and get into the world that God has prepared for us. And there again, you can do it so many different ways also. I don't think anyone likes a world of poverty. I mean, I really don't think anyone does, but you got to do something to get out of it. So in order to build another world, okay, let's leave the world of poverty. How about we leave the world of lack even? How about we leave the world of even just getting by, okay? You know, let's leave the world of poverty and penury, okay? Those two categories cover everything I just mentioned. Let's leave that world. Well, we got to do something to build a world of prosperity. We better start thinking it, believing it, confessing it, declaring it, and then we might want to go get a job. I mean, you know. I don't claim to be the sharpest tool in the shed or the brightest crayon in the box, but I figured this one out when I was about 16. If you want some money, am I going to work for it? You know? So anyway, so we want to leave that world of poverty and penury. Let's go build a world of prosperity and let's start working. Okay, we're working and realize, well, okay, I'm not really going to reach my financial goals. So, okay, well, keep your day job. Turn to someone and say, keep your day job. Go back to school, right? Or keep your day job and start that side business. Keep your day job and start that business in that spare bedroom. Oh, you don't have a spare bedroom? Start it in your shed in the backyard. Oh, you don't have a shed? Start it in your garage. Oh, you don't have a garage? Well, start it outside under a tree. You know, I mean, the Lord's calling you to do that. Start it. Wherever you need to, go start it then, you know. But anyway, that's how you leave the world of that. And the list goes on. I know you know this. So we're good and clear and all that. Yeah. You know, I want to make this real clear also. See, Abraham, he didn't like the world he was living in Ur of the Chaldees. He didn't like that world. And that's why he God began to stir him up. So Abraham went and built another one. Because he discovered, oh, I'm following the one who's a builder and maker. So God wants me to build something, because Ur of the Chaldees, it ain't happening here. Bunch of idolatry, idol worshiping, heathenistic people who rail against God and make fun of them. None of them attend CIC. I'm tired of hanging out with these people. So, you know, and then family members dying and all that there. He say, man, this place is cursed. I'm out of here. Vamanos. Yeah. For all of you English only speaking people, that means let's go. I think so, doesn't it? So anyway, so let's go. So Abraham, he was all about building another world. But here's the thing. It's not just for himself, but for his family. He took his family. He even took that spoiled brat called Lot. He even took him and said, let's get out of here. Let's get the Hades out of here, man. Let's go. Let's build. Hades is Greek for hell. Okay, I got to keep moving here. Let's get out of here. Which Jesus used that word quite a bit, if you ever notice. Of course, he was talking about the literal place, but also the figurative. Okay, we need to keep moving here. But anyway, that's another thing. When you build a better world, you need to take people with you. Yes. The ones who want to go. The ones who you are responsible for, you want to take them with you as much as possible. Now, if they don't want to go, you got to leave the old man behind. You got to leave the people who want to stay dead. You got to leave them behind as Abraham did, because he said, what's ahead of me is filled with life, and I'm going to build something in the future for not only me, but for others who are connected with me. Amen. In order to build, you got to have a few things. Simple as this. First and foremost, you got to have a plan. Plans, even plural, right? Because when someone is going to build a house or even a big room addition, you do have a plan, but it's plural, plans, plural, because there's more than one sheet to it. So your plan actually should be plural. You should have several sheets to your set of plans, also known as blueprints, right? You should need to say, here's the blueprint for your life. Here's a blueprint for your life. So what you need to do is you need to take it from here, put it down, tailor fit for you, tailor made just for you, right? Want the plan that you want. What do you want to build? Not what others think you should build.
Oh, wow. Come on, Pastor.
Now, I don't know about you, but I'm going to build a house. I'm going to build it how I want it. I don't care if anyone else likes it or not. I mean, they will, of course, but, the point, right? Because some might not. They might not like that given style. Ain't building it for them. Now, until they want to write the check, just stay over there and keep your mouth shut, right? When you go out to build a house, you're going to build your dream home, right? It's your dream home. It's what you want. You design it how you want to design it, right? So it is, now figuratively, with your life. You get your tailor-made plan, not what others think, not what others. I mean, if you want a few people to weigh in and, kind of give a little counsel here, and that's a good thing. Somebody said that's a good thing. But other than that, you build it how you want to build it. It's your life. As Frank Sinatra said, do it your way, okay? With God, by all means, absolutely. He is the co-builder, right? You're working together with him to build. But get your plan. Somebody say, get a plan. You got to have a plan. We spent the first month of this new year focusing just on that. Plan / goals / dreams, aspirations in life, they're really all the same. You need to have them all. You should have a plan. You should know, okay, this is what I want to build in my life. This is what I eventually want to see. Now, it's going to take some time. But eventually, I'm going to get there, right? And I'm going to occupy it even as I'm building it. Somebody say again, get a plan. Get a plan. Write that thing down. Write the vision down. Habakkuk chapter 2. Make it plain. That way that when you read it and others read it, they can understand what has been written down, what has been actually put down on paper even for you. Make sure you have a plan. You're going to build. This is how I want to build my life. These are the areas I'm going to build in my life and how I want to do it. This is how I'm going to build my marriage. This is how I'm going to build relationships. This is how I'm going to build all of those things. When you have a plan, you have a clear-cut objective. Only when you have a plan can you measure what you are building. Only when you have a plan can you measure what you are building. If you don't have a plan, you're going to meander everywhere. You're not going to be able to assess and take stock of what you have done and what you have accomplished. So there again, somebody say, get a plan. Also, in order to build, you got to have some resources. You have to have some resources. Bottom line, two areas of resources. A lot of things underneath these two categories, but bottom line, you have to have two resources. One is you got to have financial resources. You got to have some money. Somebody say, need some money. You got to have some money. Now, so it is with your own life. It takes finances to build your life. And this has been quite a while ago, and someone's probably going to Google this, so I'm not even going to get close, even though I do have a phenomenal memory. But it's been years ago, and I'm sure the data has changed now. But anyway, on what it costs, I think the data now is probably close to 10 years ago, what it costs to raise a child today. From the time they were born, yeah, some of you say, I felt that. Yeah, I feel that one right now. Still feeling that one, Pat. So from the time they're a child until they're 18, right? It was hundreds of thousands of dollars. Let me digress just a moment. Let me speak to the children here whose parents attend this church. Make your mom and daddy proud and become super rich and take care of them. How's that? They pumped a lot of money to get you to where you are at. Oh, let me keep going here. Then anyway, the bottom line, it takes finances to build anything. I mean, look at this in the spiritual realm. Look what it costs for God to build your life. His only begotten Son. It costs Jesus his life's blood and his very life in order to build us into the eternal weight of existence of who we are even now. So it costs everything you look at, everything took money. There had to be some financial resources behind that. And then in conjunction with that, you have to have the resource of perseverance. And sometimes this is more important than money. Because money, there's going to be ebb and flow of money. How many of you realize that? Sometimes the ebb is much more ebbing than the flowing of the money. But there's an ebb and flow of money. And it's like, man, it's ebbing away even, right? But anyway, it's going to flow back into our lives in Jesus' name. The financial flow is coming in by waves in Jesus' name into your life. Amen. Receive that. The financial flow is coming, going to crash on in waves upon your life, beginning this week in Jesus' name. So those resources also, the financial, you have to have the resource of perseverance. There again, finances, you know, they're going to ebb and flow. People are going to come and go. Things are going to cycle in, cycle out. The weather's going to change. You know, in Phoenix, it just goes from hot to not quite as hot. But anyway, but things change in life. And the cycles and seasons and all of that just occur. You know, sometimes you're going to be really motivated. Sometimes you're not going to be motivated. Sometimes you're going to be burnt out. To be 100%, there will be sometimes you're going to be kind of burnt out in building this wonderful thing called your life. Right? You're going to deal with a lot of different things. You're going to have to encourage yourself when you're battling discouragement. Not only is no one else encouraging you, but even you're battling discouragement. You got to encourage yourself. You got to prophesy to your dead bones. You got to say these bones are going to live. This thing is going to work. This is going to come to pass. You got to talk to yourself in spiritual psalms and hymns. I mean, you got to do everything. You got to pull out that arsenal. I mean, you got to speak in tongues. You got to get in the Word every single day and every single night. You got to have a strong prayer life. You got to put on that whole armor every day. Sometimes that armor is so heavy, it takes all you got to put it on, but you got to put it on every day. It's called persevering. Perseverance, it is one of the greatest character traits that God could ever give you. You know, when Jesus said this, he said, listen, Peter, of course, hours before Christ was led away to be beaten and eventually nailed to his cross. He said this to Peter. He was talking to his disciples. Judas had already left. And he's getting really, really intimate relationship with his disciples. He said, look, here's what's going to happen. This is going to go on. And then he said, hey, Peter, just for what it's worth, you're going to deny me three times before this night's up, just for what it's worth. But I already know you're going to do that, and I've already prayed. Can you wrap your brain around that one? Can you wrap your brain around that one? That the Lord knows that we have the propensity and also even not only the possibility, but the all likelihood of falling, of sinning or whatever, falling short again. But he's already prayed before we do it for us to be restored. I don't know about you, but that just makes me go, my. And he said, you know, Simon, Satan has a desire to have you, sift you as wheat, that he may have you and basically pull you apart and destroy you and all that. And he went on to say, but I prayed for you. But I prayed for you. And when you are converted, meaning when you come back, when you repent and you get things right again, you restore, which Peter did. He said when that happened, he went out and he wept bitterly. Ever notice that? I'm not saying you always got to cry when you repent, but it sure does help a little bit. But let's just keep moving. Oh, I'm going to digress a moment on that. I'm sorry, but I'm going to go old school here a minute. Some of you remember this term. And because I have a little problem with a dry salvation. I have a little problem. Someone say, oh, I gave my heart and life to Jesus. Ain't no emotion there. Not even a tear there. And it's like, I know 1/10 of what you've done. And you ain't that sorry for it? You ought to be falling out on the floor. Oh, Jesus! You ought to be crying tears and slinging snot from here to Yuma. I mean, you just should be. It's like, I don't know where that one came. I'm sorry. Let's keep moving. You ought to be hugging everyone. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. For 3 months. That dry salvation, no tears, no emotion. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. Where's the heart, man? What happened to the heart of the church? What happened to the soul within the church? What happened to some passion and some emotion? Where in the world has it all gone? Oh, Jesus, help us. But anyway, where are we at? We got to get back to this. Persevere. You got to just keep persevering because you're going to go through stuff. And no one's going to fully relate or equate what you're going through. So you just have to buck up, man, and just keep going. Cowboy up. Whatever term works for you. But, you know, as you're building your life, helping to build the lives of other people, and sometimes, you know, it's not coming together as fast as you wanted it to and all of that kind of stuff. You're being attacked in different areas. Your resources are being diminished, depleted, and gone, and everything. You name it. You just need to realize just every day's a new day. Bottom line, you know, if you just get up in the morning and just keep moving, somebody say keep moving, you're going to get there. If you have to crawl for a couple days, crawl, but just keep moving.
For more information about our teaching resources, visit our website at ciclive.com.